Greetings, welcome to RLM TV. Thanks for tuning in tonight.
Amen, welcome back.
Just want to talk to you here at the beginning with something that you deal with every single day since you first believed God's word is the truth. So we get saved, we begin to believe in Jesus Christ, we often go to church, some go to Bible college, some go to Teen Challenge. You know, we all have different streams of our background, but it's one mountain. So we all come out of different sands, which is different flesh, different DNA, but it's one mountain. It's not like all the streams lead to God, but if you are obedient to his streams, you know, like Streams Ministries, John Paul Jackson, those streams will lead to the mountain, and the mountain will lead to the one ladder. So the mountain is really not a narrow path, it's a gigantic mountain. And we know from the Final Quest series by Rick Joyner, people are going up the mountain from all the nations all around it. And usually we think our one little side of it is all that exists. In fact, there are caverns inside it. There are chutes and ladders inside of it. It's gigantic, okay? Where it becomes extremely narrow, extremely thin, is the ladder of the tree of life on the top of the mountain. So I want to talk about all the streams leading to the mountain, which is all the nations streaming into Zion, Book of Revelation of Jesus Christ, it is written. The twisting of truth disconnects scripture from the ladder. Remember, the ladder is what connects the mountain to the Father's throne. If it's disconnected, it don't matter if you're on the mountain. You could be on the top of the mountain. You could be on the ladder. But if you disconnect scripture from Jesus Christ, the ladder, John 1:5-1, you are now practicing rebellion, which is witchcraft, before Jesus Christ, who is Yad He Vav He. So Numbers 24 says that Balaam augured before YHVH, Torah. Okay, we have that in our Torah. You have several chapters of what all the sorcerers are trying to do to pick you off every day. We think, oh, I'm exempt from that. I believe in Jesus Christ. That could not be further from the truth. That's all you deal with in the sand. That's all you deal with on the mountain. All your circumcisions of foreskin, membrane, and bloodletting of Jesus Christ from the sands of time to the mountain of the Lord and all the latter for eternities without end. You come to a place in eternities where you're not dealing with that. But right now, everyone's dealing with it. Everyone is dealing with the cruelty of the world, the harshness of the world, the trauma of being born in a fallen world, some more than others. You know, some people, they have parents that pray in tongues and they raise them in the way in which they should go. So when they're older, they do not depart far from it. But most parents are not good parents. Most parents are terrible parents that don't even lead people to God. They actually lead them to the enemy. You have parents selling their kids into sex slavery all over the world. And that's documented. That's truth. You have bad parents sacrificing their children on altars to demons in scripture. And some of you watching right now were actually dedicated to the occult from birth. And you wonder why life is so rough. Listen, this isn't a self-pity. This isn't to feel bad for ourselves. Mm-hmm. It's to actually illuminate reality, to make way to the mountain to get healed today. We can talk about how cruel the world is, how terrible the devil is, how evil Pharaoh is, and the taskmasters that beat us, lacerated us, whipped us, destroyed us, killed our children, killed our hopes, killed our dreams, killed, stolen, and destroyed everything we wanted to do since birth, and that would be true, except Jesus provides an exodus through the Reed Sea, through the Red Sea, into the wilderness to get the serpents off of our arms, our heads, our bodies, and our hearts, and our minds, and our DNA, and our consciousness, and our memories. The receiving of the instruction from the mountain of Sinai, which is prophetic ministry. A lot of people think prophetic ministry is Zion. That's not true. Scripture says when the perfect arrives, the prophetic is no more. When the perfect arrives, the prophetic is no more. That's written in 1 Corinthians chapter 14. Therefore, the prophetic is Sinai. Truth anyhow. Write that in the comments. The prophetic witness, Elijah, the prophetic ministry is Mount Sinai. Truth anyhow. Because in Zion, there is no more prophets. Because the Bible says when the perfect comes, the prophetic is gone, and the speaking in tongues is gone, and all the gifts of the Spirit are no more. Well, last time I checked, everyone still has the gifts in the Spirit who's baptized in the whole world right now, like 100 million people. So it could not be further from the truth. But we need to understand what Sinai is, because everyone and their grandma's got an opinion about everything down here, and they're wrong, because the nefesh is always wrong. Mm-hmm. We need to learn from a higher ladder, from a higher authority, higher than us, and be teachable like clay in the potter's hands. Bob Jones said when the sons of God manifest, you'll have to relearn everything you learned. I heard him say it 100 times.
He said that, did he?
100 times. Amazing. I heard Bob Jones say that. When the sons of God manifest, the church will have to relearn every single thing they've learned.
So does that include the fivefold ministry, discernment, praying in tongues, how to please God, how to have unity, what the nefesh needs, what the ruah needs, what we need for training? Yes, it includes all of that and much more.
Amen.
It's a complete overhaul of Christianity. And what was, someone has kept the prophecy to around and posted it from time to time, that was about the entire, it was a prophecy that the entire face of Christianity, or the look of Christianity, would completely transform
in
one generation. Yeah, it's going to transform. Yeah, and what does that mean? It's
going to
be
Mike Bickle's transformation.
Amen. We forgive Mike Bickle.
Amen.
And all kinds of people need forgiveness. It's so easy for us to look at, you know, people who have like a public figure, or, you know, when you have a calling or a destiny, and people get really attacked by the demonic. And what happens is when we fall for the bait of the demons, we step outside of our protection. And that's when people end up, you know, like some of these charismatic leaders, they've really started out in the spirit. They really have a true destiny and a true calling. But what happens? They take some bait of some appearance of a mitzvah or appearance of revelation, and when they have wounds, then the magic spell kindles on the wounds, and they take the bait and they go into the clippeth, and they don't know that they're getting clipped. And but because it feels like glory and revelation and understanding, that's mm-hmm. what Black Bina is, the mother, false mother Lilith yep. of the Black Moon, is understanding. That's why there was always that, I need to know, you know, it's for mm-hmm. my brain, and it has to make sense to me, and it feels glorious and all this stuff. A lot of times people think the best revelations they've had of their life and a glorious experience, it's actually just clippeth activity. Yep. Now, it's really easy. We could go and look at all the leaders of all, you know, the kingdom of God that have ever been clipped, mm-hmm. who have ever tripped and clipped, you know?
The Kelopot ladder is building upon carnal knowledge about God, auguring mm-hmm. before Jesus Christ.
And a lot of the Kelopot building is upon the sweetness of stolen honey and stolen bread, glory experiences, feeling. It's yep. about feeling the presence. Well, stolen glory mimics the divine presence. That's what the Tower of Jezebel is. It's the mimicking of the divine presence by stealing from Shekinah, who is the daughter of Seven, the final hey of the Tetragrammaton, our mother. So when she's not receiving the emanations from above because of the sins of the people of Israel who are in exile, she goes with them in exile. So when she's not receiving that and it's going to the other side, Lilith gets it. And who does she give it to? Everyone in Jezebel's tower.
Yep.
And that's because Lilith is the mother of Jezebel.
And the sorcerers of Babylon get
it. And Molech is their father. And Satan is their father.
Truth.
You know, it's all false fathering and false mothering. But what happens is people who are innocent, who start off in the spirit, get deceived. They get hurt. Somebody came and hurt them. And guess what? Then there was a wound there. Then they wanted to hurt somebody else because they'd been hurt. Mm. So everybody in the whole world, especially in Christianity, especially if you're a spiritual person in general, has been hurt and targeted by the clippeth. Now, what we don't want it to become is, let's say, you know, some of you watching this right now, you've been severely traumatized by the wicked. You've been severely traumatized by even well-meaning people who thought they were serving God. He said in the Word of God, they'll think they're doing God a favor, but they'll be murdering you.
Yeah.
But they really had a pure, what they thought a pure intention.
Matthew 5.
But there was a hidden motive in the subconscious and the unconscious. So it's a messed up world. But what we don't need is a comparison. So let's say all the stuff that you've been through, you're watching. Yes, you. Yes, I'm talking to you watching at home right now. All that stuff that you were traumatized with. The temptation is to hurt others and perpetuate the seed. What's the difference? What's going to set us apart? That's what everybody else does in the world. What's going to set us apart? It's not about whether or not you've been traumatized. We could point out people's mistakes.
That's why they say counselors need the most counseling.
Mm-hmm. Yep. And so we could point out drama, but what's the difference? The only thing that sets us apart is how we respond to having been traumatized walking through this world. There is either bitterness and clippeth or cosmic ascension and righteousness. Everyone on this path has been wounded and hurt severely in many different ways. The only thing that sets us apart is that we go up with circumcision of heart. That's the only difference. Other than that, we're just the same kind of flesh and blood,
yeah,
the same kind of broken ruah, the same kind of messed up nefesh with all its problems. But God's doing a great work in you. He's doing a great work. And so we have to trust every step along the way. It is the ladder plus nothing. Every demon and all the clippeth will want us to understand their reality, which is the ladder plus this, plus the shell.
Mm.
Because the shell is a clippeth, they want to remain. So when we go the ladder plus nothing, bye-bye clippeth,
yeah,
that means I trust that this circumcision and this ladder and staying in the ladder has everything I need and more, because Jesus is the ladder. He said he's the ladder in the book of John. So when you say the ladder plus nothing, you're saying Jesus plus nothing.
Amen.
Not plus me, my opinions, your opinions, all those other things. The ladder plus nothing. Put that in the comments. The ladder plus nothing.
Keep it simple.
Because
truth, anyhow.
Because that's going to destroy the Klippeth, and they're the ones who are the guilty ones. And now, even Amen. Though we've been guilty, even though all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, the mercy seat of Jesus Christ, his blood and water poured out for us, is making us innocent.
It flows through the ladder, plus nothing.
Plus nothing.
The ladder is filled with the blood and water of Jesus, our mercy seat, plus nothing.
Amen. And so if there's one thing that we want to understand, that's all there is. All the healing that we need, we just keep going up.
Amen.
All the character changes and the flaws that we have, those get changed as we go up. And that's it. And when we come to this next rung, and then you know, here I'm at my rung, here you are at your rung, you guys are watching. It might be Malkud, it might be Hod, it might be Netzah, it might be Tiferet, it could be Gevra, you know, has said, and on and on and on, worlds without end. But what is the change that God requires of us at each rung? And it comes through studying the word of that rung, the one that we're on, and the next one. That is what's going to make the change. Now, what we don't want to do is blame the people in our past. So-and-so, they hurt me. They did all this damage. Look, God created the heavens and the earth and all that's in it. And I was studying oral tradition literally last night, and it said that he was not, the Hebrew there means that he was not fatigued at all. Like the creation of the physical dimension didn't even fatigue him at all. It was like effortless.
I think believers need to understand God didn't create the devil. Now hold on. God did not create Satan and his angels. Satan and his angels were created holy cherubim, holy seraphim, perfect angels. They made themselves bitter by disobeying God, just like so many people do down here on earth. So understand, God is not the author of confusion or wrongdoing. Mm-hmm. He's never sinned. He's totally innocent. We must judge God perfect always. And understand, everything wrong was from independence of disobeying him. Everything wrong with you, wrong with me, and wrong with what you've gone through is from people who have disobeyed God and who have obeyed demons, including all of us. So now we're learning obedience to a different master. The word Lord means master, Adonai. Well, if Jesus is your master, you obey me, therefore you love me. That's how you get healed. The disobedience is staying under the same master that caused all the damage to your family, to your finances, to your health, to your mental well-being, and everything else. So obedience is the evidence that you're on the path to be healed in your hearts and your minds and your souls, and go up towards Ein Sof healing, which means infinite healing. There is healing that is beyond human comprehension, and it's not even to be calculated. It's not even to be comprehended. It is beyond anything you can expect, imagine, or hope, or pray for by the dunamis resurrection power that he so mightily enkindles and works within you. Colossians 1, Ephesians 2, it is written. So God is wanting to do this thing bypassing your carnal mind for literally worlds. We need to understand this, because in order to get healed, you have to leave your mind on the altar and get healed in your heart. Did you not know a believer subjugated to their carnal mind, which is their dat, your pineal gland, the bone throne of Satan, is a servant of the devil all the time? A Christian that only serves their mind, right, their intellect, their own carnal intelligence, it says in Romans 8:7, is the arch enemy of Jesus Christ himself. Guys, that's 99% of believers right now, and we need to repent, and we need to get out of serving Satan in the carnal mind, serving our own intellect, serving our own intelligence, and begin to crucify that thing and put our mind down on the altar of fire of the Holy Ghost. Out of your belly flows rivers of the fire of the Holy Ghost to burn your mind, so that we can start walking with him in holiness. The main problem, infants, which is all of you watching right now at the sound of my voice, is that you value your human intellect, your carnal mind, way too highly, and the altar of fire, the Holy Ghost in your belly, way too lowly. We often trample our holy place. We trample the Holy Spirit. We trample the Lion of the Tribe of Judah in us, Christ in us, and we start to serve God in a make-believe Disneyland of our own carnal brains, finding ourselves in the enemy's camp, finding ourselves the enemies of the Holy Ghost more often than not. Repentance is returning your brain, your mind, your human intelligence, your intellect, your pineal gland to the throne of God in your belly and burning it. If you cannot return your mind, your intellect, and your pineal gland, your DAT, in the center of your brain to the altar of fire in your belly, you'll never get past an infant in Christ. You'll never make one step in the correct direction towards the mountain of the Lord or the ladder of the Lord. This is the first thing that needs to be sacrificed. Your brain, your intellect, your human intelligence, on the fire of the Holy Ghost, God's intelligence, in order to begin the germination of the mustard seed of the kingdom, the God's sperm genetics that he imparted into you when you first believed the word of God. 1 John, it is written. Truth anyhow. Somebody type truth anyhow. Amen. I'm talking to you now because I want you to make it. I want you to be successful. This is how so many become the enemies of Jesus while they think they're serving Jesus. The devil comes and tempts them right here in their dat. And so it builds the kelipot ladder of the clippeth right upon their mind, and it just goes up, you know, into the abyss. And it just becomes this entire red camp of Esau and his emotionalism and Balaam's sorceries and the scholar demon and all the fallen angels entirely in false Christianity. That's the Whore of Babylon of the book of Revelation, truth anyhow, perfectly painted before your eyes. So it's building upon the shifting sand of man's mind as the building of the laborers in vain, truth anyhow. If we can sacrifice our carnal mind, Romans 8:7, to the Holy Ghost, and be controlled by the Spirit in our mind for worlds. Mm-hmm. I believe you can't even begin using your mind until you're in the ninth week of the ninth world, having been resurrected on the ladder, that many circumcisions. I believe that's 100% accurate. Mm-hmm. That's what Rebecca's been teaching. It's the truth anyhow, which means if this thing is not on the altar for many, many worlds, the nine worlds, 9 weeks going up. If we get into this, we'll find ourselves auguring before Jesus Christ in witchcraft. We need to repent and serve him on the altar. Amen.
Amen. That's so true. I want somebody to put in the comments, it's still not for my brain.
It's still not for my brain. Truth anyhow.
It's the carnal mind. Your brain is that seat of the carnal mind, which is at enmity against who? God.
Against, well, Jesus.
And I was studying oral tradition again last night, looking through some of the terms, and one of the terms for enmity, sitna, it means Satan clippeth. The definition of enmity, according to the Orthodox Judaism, is Satan clippeth.
Satan clippeth.
And he put enmity between the man and the woman. So what does that mean? Married couples watching at home, you have to overcome the Satan clippeth between the male and the female, because original design is, imagine a middle pillar here between Brandon and I, and that represents God, and I'm on the female side and he's on the male side, and then we come together. That's holy marriage. That's holy matrimony. So, but what happened in the curse of the fall is there became Satan clippeth in between the man and the woman.
Yep.
And so what does that mean? You have to shed the snake skin, the peel of the shell. Yep. You have to get rid of the clippeth, and then that's when there's peace. And so that's what we war every day. You have to fight for your family. You have to fight for your loved ones, but our weapons are not carnal, which means they're not understanding in your brain. Carnal, fallen, earthly, demonic. Our weapons are not carnal brain. Our weapons are not carnal. It doesn't just mean not guns. The Peshat level interpretation of parties is not guns and knives, duh. We have that for like established for at least a thousand years, I think. But our weapons are not carnal, which means not this, not this, not how I feel, not how I think about it, but how the river is doing, what the river is doing, which always blows our mind.
Yeah,
it's not for the brain. And I think that's where people struggle, because they're like, I'm trying to pray, I'm trying to read the Bible, but it's so hard. It's always so hard for the brain, because the carnal mind is at enmity 24/7.
Zero dat, 3, 6, 5.
I like that.
Zero dat,
that's where it's at.
Amen.
Amen. I like that.
Woo.
That's good.
Rejecting the debt is putting the tree mm-hmm. that we ate back on the mm-hmm. fruit that we ate back on the tree. Mm-hmm. It's returning everything that we ate in the fall mm-hmm. back to where God had originally mm-hmm. designed.
I like to do this disco move, dance move, to remind myself every time I make the jump from like, if from the Hesed to Bina. You know the little disco move? You pick the apple, put it in the basket. You know that one? This one? Just but oh, reverse instead of picking the apple. Don't you guys know this one? Everyone knows that one, right? I grew up, you know, it's a little disco move. But you like pick the apple, put it in the basket. But this time you take the apple, put it back. Put it back, woman. Soul, that's for the guys too. Put it back.
Amen.
Take it from your soul and put it back.
So in the fall, we gained all of our power here in the mind, in the pineal gland, literally, which is the bridge between left brain, right brain, Bina and Hakma, mm-hmm. and it's entirely fallen. And so in the resurrection of Jesus Christ, mm-hmm. we're saying, I'm not going to be operating out of the bone throne of Satan, mm-hmm. out of my dad. I'm going to operate out of my spirit as original design, like Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden. So it's true repentance of the entire curse of the fall.
Amen. I know some people are putting the emojis. You guys know what I'm talking about, that dance move. What I want to say is Adam and Eve, the book of Adam and Eve or
Adam
the 12
and Eve
patriarchs.
Disco class.
Yeah, Adam and Eve disco class.
That'll be for
take
the special
apple,
subscribers.
Put it back on the tree.
For the patrons. Or
for the love of God, put it back. We don't need that. Put it back. Just go through the flashing swords of Zotiel. There's a key there. But it was either this is one of my favorite things in my study this week. It was either Patriarchs or Adam and Eve, one of those books, something like that, where the angel basically looks at him and says, I don't know. And he tells him, amen. I can't tell you. He says, I can't tell you because I don't know that.
They're not omniscient.
They don't need to know. And why didn't he know? It's always with the angels on a need-to-know basis.
Amen.
They don't need to know, and they're not bothered by it. He just literally said, I can't tell you that because I don't know. And so, I said, well, so that's good.
Amen.
That means he must not need to know because he doesn't need to tell
You'd
him.
You'd be surprised how little your guardian angels actually know.
Holy.
They only know what they need to know.
It's on a need to know.
To get you to the next level.
So what I'm just proposing is if that archangel doesn't need to know.
Amen.
I don't need to know. To obey, what is matzah? You do it without understanding it.
That's right.
Oh.
Not for your thinker, for your drinker.
Amen.
Truth
and river of life, and it's the same way all the way up. And now that's what the ninth week is really interesting. Like Brandon said, that's the first orbital of Dat, which means it's our very first little tiny taste of getting a little bit of the Holy Spirit of knowledge added back
yeah.
into our pineal gland.
Can I describe what I'm experiencing?
Oh, yeah.
In that,
please do.
Because you have Jesus, who's called in Isaiah 11:2, the Spirit of knowledge. So now it's Jesus Christ's throne instead of the bone throne of Satan beginning to operate through the pineal gland, which is the mind, and control the mind for the inner intelligence of God the Father for serving him, you know, as a greater and higher angel on higher angelic rungs. But you're still dealing with the humiliation of the curse of the fall at the same time in the mind mm-hmm. that's always trying to wrestle and take control against the throne of Jesus Christ in your own members. This is why Apostle Paul says, I wrestle sin in my own members. It's true, because you're actually mm-hmm. wrestling DNA, scrolls, different types of programming in flesh and in bone and in marrow and in soul and in spirit. And you're allowing Jesus to win and you to lose to Jesus. And when you lose to Jesus, you win against the red dragon. And that's really what all of this boils down to. The red dragon, the beast, and the false prophet were thrown down the lake of fire. That represents that the sanctification of Jesus Christ has won in your members. Losing is that not allowing Jesus to win, and oftentimes him winning is... You know, if a six-year-old girl can correct you and you can obey the latter, or a horse come around and correct you and you obey the white horse or the unicorn, or something that's so out of your mind that requires you to obey something you can't calculate with your carnal thinking that's stinking. And if you can still obey it, and it confesses Jesus Christ came in the flesh, and it's from Jacob's ladder of Jesus Christ, and then comes the breakthrough because you've obeyed in the unknown, which is the Ein Sof, which causes a greater Shekinah and your ascension. Amen.
Amen. You guys remember the orchard parties? We talked about the orchard, the different interpretations of the level of Torah. So Torah, the simplest one was the little seeds. Like, what am I supposed to do? Gnaw on these seeds? And then you have like... and then we have like...
Chew the cud.
Chew the cud. And then we have like the allegorical hint. And I'm cheating off of my notes because I couldn't remember all of them. But the allegorical hint, we had the bread, and then we had the midrashic, which was like, we use a picture of the cupcake, right? The cake, the delicious cakes. And then the highest level interpretation, according to rabbinical Orthodox Judaism, is royal pastry. And for me, that is like, you know, the little Starbucks pastry, the cream cheese Danish. That is the ultimate for me. Mm. Or at least in like a nice coffee shop. Like a hole-in-the-wall coffee shop.
No evil eye.
That's locally owned. And they just made it with love. And the angel went ahead of you that day to like create it through the people there with the forgiveness of their sins that you blessed the establishment with before you got there. And then it was just like glowing and radiating Shekinah. So when you tasted it, only praises could come out of your mouth because of the goodness of God.
And some royal pastry is just an egg McMuffin through McDonald's drive-thru.
Hey, that could be your pastry.
To each their own. Right. It's symbolic.
Right. So everybody wants the royal pastry, which is what? Sod. So we have a Peshat, Remez, Darash, and Sod. And that represents Asaya, Yetzira, Berea, and Atzilut. Which, what are those? All those worlds? They're a scroll. So when the heavens are rolled up, and the earth, the old earth and the old heavens are rolled up like a scroll, the ones that he's getting rid of to be replaced with the new ones, it says it's rolled up like a scroll. It's like, okay, we're going to roll that one in and just chunk that one out.
Amen.
And here's a new, better one.
Better scroll.
Better scroll ministries.
Wow.
So for now, we're just studying the word of God in the Peshat, the Remez, the Darash, and the Sod. That's what we study. Those are the levels and the layers of interpretation. But what is the world of Isaiah, specifically Malkut, what does it represent? Yeah, all of Isaiah represents a big Malkut. It represents the need for the Peshat, which is what? The simple word. The simple word is for the Nefesh. Here's some seeds. Yum, yum, yum.
And no temper tantrums. That's all it needs. Come on.
But I might break my tooth on this. That might hurt my understanding, my wisdom with this kernel. But what's amazing is, like Brandon was saying, we have to treasure it in the spirit, not in the brain. So the seed, the Peshat, is for the Nefesh. Why? In this world that we walk in, we do Bible spa. Because it's not for our brain. It's not for our heart yet. Take those seeds of the simple meaning, plant it in the river of Shekinah in your belly. And the seed already knows how to grow on autopilot. We just got to be faithful to not steal it to our brain and our heart. Especially when we come into contact with these higher wisdoms or this interpretation, like the allegorical, you know, like the remez, the bread, the cake, the darash. The midrashic interpretations, the mystical, which is like, you know, the Zohar. That's why we go, our whole tribe, you know, we do not go in and study the oral tradition of Moses. We don't have our people reading texts like the Zohar or the Kabbalah text. And I wouldn't even really go for the midrashic texts or anything like that. It's not fruitful and it can be very harmful for your Ruach spirit. Until you're grown up as a tree, when you're faithful with the Peshat, simple meaning, and you put it in the river, and you just obey,
it's
eat the matzah.
For your protection, you'll get augured like that if you disobey that, because you need to develop your spirit first, and you need obedience in the mitzvahs to get to the mountain. Later on, there are libraries as your spirit grows up. It's always glory to glory, but you have to obey down there and deny the knowledge, and obey the mitzvah. See, that's really how you mm-hmm. begin your journey back home, is denying mystical knowledge, true knowledge from mm-hmm. God. If you can't do that, you'll just go from bad to worse.
Yeah.
Because you're a scholar demon. You just love knowledge. Your own mind is your God. Jesus, you don't listen to anything he says. You don't obey him in anything. He's not mm-hmm. your God. He's not your master. You are your master, and therefore Satan still is your Lord. Until you repent and value obedience more than the learning mm-hmm. of information about God in your head, you yeah. can't even be a disciple. In fact, you'll have so much drama in your mm-hmm. life that's completely unnecessary, simply because you've not obeyed him mm-hmm. and you just want knowledge about him. So mm-hmm. obedience is better than sacrifice. You need it in the heart to build up your heart, obey mm-hmm. instruction, and disobey all of the longings of the lust mm-hmm. of the mind for mm-hmm. information.
Yeah.
That is more wicked than even Lilith and Jezebel yeah. of the genitalia. Truth yeah. anyhow, the scholar demon that seeks knowledge about God is the highest ranking fallen angels of the kingdom of hell, okay? And that's the main thing tempting everyone in Christianity mm-hmm. and Judaism, and we need to obliterate that and begin to value mm-hmm. obedience from the heart like little children, and then only learn mm-hmm. what he's teaching us in the classroom of obedience to his word. Because if you begin to make your mind your God, you become the greatest enemies of Jesus Christ during these days. Truth anyhow.
Ooh, that is so good. That's so true. Definitely save that and just hold tight to that truth so they don't clip you.
Yeah.
Right. And so let's say that the royal pastry level, the highest level interpretation, the stuff that everybody wants to get after, instead of calling it royal pastry, let's call it candy, because people like candy, right? Now, imagine Satan is the stranger in the car with the candy. You know how to say no to strangers in cars with candy, right? You learned that growing up. Hopefully you learned that growing up.
Yeah.
If you didn't,
don't take candy from strangers.
Don't take candy from strangers. So all of that mystical stuff, the mystic interpretation and the Zohar, the Midrashic stuff, all the Talmudic, all these different, you know, mysteries and secrets about Moses and about God. Listen, if you're in the world of Isaiah, and you're not at Hesed of Isaiah, at least with full circumcisions of those rungs, that stuff is going to hurt you. You're going to end up with the candy and the stranger in his car going somewhere you don't need to be going. And not knowing, because look, I've got all this candy. I have all this knowledge. I have all this revelation. Well, what's the point? Revelation that conducts Shekinah is revelation that brings forth peace. So whenever you open your mouth or you scribe and you write things to share revelation, or when you want to speak what you're learning, you know, like RLM TV, if those words don't conduct peace or increase the peace, that's a sign it's on the other side. That's how you know it's, even though it's true, there's nothing wrong with what you're saying, it's just clippeth activity. Because why? It's not conducting peace. If it attacks Shekinah and steals from Shekinah, it's not a gemstone filled with living light. It's not a living stone.
Mm-hmm.
It's a dead stone. And so it doesn't mean that that information can't come in handy later. It's just doing destruction. The whole clip of this is built on truth.
Disconnected but scripture.
Truth disconnected from Jesus. Jesus is yeah. the truth. He is the Aleph and the Tav. He is the glory.
Babylon the Great is the sandcastle that goes up 11 weeks, 11 worlds high, that is built entirely on disconnected scripture. Disconnected things stolen from God, mainly the mm-hmm. Bible, Jewish wisdom, and Christian wisdom. That is what Babylon the Great is. It's a sandcastle built of the things of God apart from the ladder of God. That's why it's so exceedingly deceiving to most people, because everything mm-hmm. they have is stolen from God. The fallen angels don't have anything mm-hmm. except for what they've stolen before Yadeh Vaveh. Numbers 24, it is written.
Amen. And even for me, in the 12th week, you would be surprised, I think some of you might be surprised, at how often when I'm doing research for my mitzvah, which means I'm focused on my mitzvah, I'm doing the research, I'm trying to find, you know, the missing pieces of the puzzle so that I can put the puzzle pieces together and I can show you the way, because this is the way. Like, how do we have all this information about this ladder? Where did that come from? Kabbalah's been around for a while, but where did the ability to come, like, to actually walk in it, get the circumcisions, and not go into the clippeth. Like, the Lord and his holy angels have really been like, show me, hey, this and this, but not this and this. Amen. Make sure it's like exactly this is how you do it. And just to get that information, it's taken like
I've watched
hours the holy and angels and hours.
The archangels of God instruct this woman for a long time, and how she tests everything over and over and refines it before she releases it. And she's barely released a portion of what she's received from God, and she just holds it and treasures it in her heart, and she only speaks and says what God has allowed her to speak and say. She is a treasure keeper of the sacred things of God, and you need to understand that, because I am a witness to how strict and serious she is with her angelic instruction from Jesus Christ every day. And it is a strictness and a rigidness that even at times challenges me to be so much more strict in my walk with Christ. Amen.
Thanks. It's true. Yeah, it's just like, you know, what we come to teach is only going to be, we want it to only be what's going to be beneficial and for the souls, for your growing. And as we grow, he's releasing more and more. So what does that mean? All those treasures of, you know, revelations, they're still not for my brain. They're not, what do I do with them? Well, that's nice. Okay, that's good. That'll come in handy when it's time to build with that, then we'll build with that. And we build together as one kingdom. You know, we are one united nation of cosmic Israel.
Amen.
Undivided, right? Mm-hmm. So, you know, what's our flag? It's the 12 flags, the 12 tribes, the 13 flags of Dinah. We have 13 flags, 13 tribes, the 12 tribes and the woman. And it's God's nation. One cosmic Israel, which is Jew, Gentile, male, female. We have people here. We have holy angels here. Yeah, living creatures. Like, I don't even know what that thing is, but it serves God. Hallelujah. Wow. Praise God. It's one kingdom. It's a glorious kingdom. Whether you're the little fluff ball floating around the meadow like an angel, or you're the living creature that's very spiky looking and very scares me anytime I see one of those things. You know,
just because it's weird doesn't mean it's not God.
Like, yeah. I don't know what that thing is.
You read Ezekiel,
it kind of scares me.
You read Zechariah, you read Daniel. I mean, the whole Bible is absolutely holy, which means strange to the human being.
Yeah, it's very strange creatures out here. But
you mentioned the flag of Dinah, and there are three tribes that are not mentioned in the book of Revelation of Jesus Christ. And I've wondered about this for over 20 years. Why are 12 tribes chosen, and we have all kinds of other tribes in the Old Testament that are called tribes that are not written in Revelation? And there's three. It's Dinah is not mentioned in Revelation, Ephraim is not mentioned, and Dan. So we have Manasseh and Joseph. Even though Manasseh is Joseph's son, both are mentioned in the Revelation list of Revelation 6 and 7. So why aren't these three listed? And God told me. He answered this mystery. This is going to blow your minds now. Dinah's the bride. So she's mentioned right there, okay? That's the bride. What about Dan? Dan is the prophetic judgment of Sinai. Dan was holy to the Lord, guys. Dan means lawyer or judge, and his flag is a serpent, which is the serpent wisdom. So it's the full completion of the prophetic on Sinai, the prophetic witness that obliterates the Kelopot and all wrongdoing in the entire earth. And so we're coming forth in the spirit and the power of Elijah that is going to be 1,000 times more than the prophets of previous generations to obliterate. So that's Dan on Sinai. That's the final prophet, the last prophetic movement that you are a part of right now in the earth, okay? But the last one's Ephraim. Ephraim means fruitfulness. Why isn't the fruitfulness of Ephraim mentioned as one of the 12 tribes? Because now all fruitfulness, instead of just Ephraim, is in Christ. It's the fruits and the fruitfulness of the Holy Spirit. And so those three are symbolically in wisdom, Jewish wisdom. It doesn't mean you just get rid of them. Oh, they didn't make the cut. No, Dan's in heaven, guys. Dinah's in heaven, okay? And Ephraim's in heaven. These were the precious, righteous tribes, the patriarchs of our faith. And they need to be honored as patriarchs and matriarchs, these ones in particular, the sons and the daughter of Jacob, Israel. And so it's very important that we have a much greater Jewish wisdom understanding these things, because what happens is the Greek teaching and the Roman teaching of Latin and Greece and the Prince of Rome and the Prince of Greece, which is Pan and Samael, come in and they twist us to turn against our own patriarchs, cutting ourselves off from salvation. We're like, we don't need Dan anymore. We don't need Dinah anymore. We don't need Ephraim anymore. Well, you just got rid of the prophetic of Sinai, which is the obliteration of wrongdoing in the earth. You just got rid of the fruitfulness of Ephraim, which is needed entirely in all the earth because you know them by their fruits. And Dinah represents the entire bride of Jesus Christ in the whole book of Revelation. So this is why we need Jewish wisdom desperately, and the uprooting of all the Greek wisdom, which is diabolical, and all the Roman wisdom, which is Samael, the very serpent that tempted Adam and Eve in the garden in the beginning.
With knowledge for their brains.
Yeah. Amen.
Here's some great knowledge for your brain. That's like the entire curse of fall. So the goal is for us not to just keep perpetuating the sin of the curse of the fall.
Amen.
Put it back. Put it back. So that's what we do. And this is how, I just wanted to share this with you because it worked. I did it. It worked. Now here, now you do it. It works. It says, Brandon did it. It works. I did it. You're going to do it. Some of you are doing it and it's working. Simple meaning. Bible spa, hand on belly, hand on spirit, engage. Like, here we go. Here we go to space.
We preach to awaken hearts. The Apostle Paul.
Not it brains. Is written,
awaken hearts. So it's your spirit man that gets energized to do mitzvahs.
Amen.
If you are not obedient from the heart, from the spirit, you never did one thing for him. So we get into our head and we get discouraged and frustrated and embittered because we did all the stuff in the bone throne of Satan. Well, no wonder why God doesn't reward that. You've only obeyed bone throne of Satan mitzvahs. Now, it's not God's fault. It's your fault. You got augured. Now, you assume responsibility for your own augury and listening to fallen angels, the dazzling demons pretending to be Jesus Christ, angels of light that deceive. And now we come back to the childlikeness and we begin to circumcise our hearts. But now it's for our heart. So all of those dragon skills, when you obey a demon and do a demonic mitzvah, you actually callous your heart against sensitivity to the Holy Ghost, and you build the black ladder of the kelapod upon your mind, making yourselves further and further away from Jesus Christ and his ladder. That's why dead works is such an abomination, because it actually removes you further and further from the cave of treasures, further and further from the cross, and further from the holy ladder of Jesus Christ. Repent and do that which I instructed you at the first. Revelation 2 and 3, that was his instruction, Messiah, to the churches. Repent and do the thing that I commanded, mitzvah, at the first. Which means return to your first love in your spirit and get all of that filth of your religiosity and your knowledge off of your spirit, off of your heart. Remember first love. That's what it actually means. Remember first love. And then begin obeying from your spirit. And now your spirit man can redevelop and regrow. All those years that the canker worm, which is the bone throne of Satan, the dat, the pineal gland, have stolen by your obedience to dark mitzvahs. Now he can restore those years if you go back into your hearts and remember first love and begin to obey him from your heart. But if you don't and you get stubborn and you continue to serve him in your own brain, you'll become a greater and greater enemy of God instead of his friend. That's in Romans 8, 7, it is written. Amen.
Amen. It's all about that simple seed, faith as little as a mustard seed, in the simple word of God. And when we watch the Bible, we read the Bible, just the simple meaning, not trying to figure it all out. There's a time for study, but if we don't have the foundation, if we lose our foundation, what we build crumbles as we go up into the cosmos. And so we want you guys to build on the solid foundation, on that rock, which is Jesus Christ. So I trust that even if I don't have the ability to understand, and I'm forsaking my own ability to understand, my own dat, how I feel about it, my own Gevra portal, simple little seed into my eyes and my ears and right down into my belly, into my spirit, in the treasury of glory. And that's good enough for me. And doing that again and again, probably hundreds of thousands of hours, I don't know how many thousands of hours we've done of Bible, but I started when I was very busy working many hours
per
week.
At least 2 hours.
A
day.
A day. Yeah, at least 2 hours a day of Bible.
Amen.
And, I'll be working like sometimes, you know, anywhere between 40 and 60 to 65 hours a week sometimes. And this is when I started. So I'm just saying, even if you have a doctor schedule, lawyer schedule, two jobs, you're working schedule, I'm telling you from experience, the time that you have is the time that you need. You think you need more time?
Right.
No, just be faithful with the time that you have.
A better manager.
You'll get more done. That's why they have that, you know, that quote, it's kind of true. Ask a busy person to get something done because they'll get it done. Why? Because they're in that flow of, you know, they have their schedule.
Time management.
Their time management. But what do we need to manage? It's give it to the river so that you're in the flow. So if all you have is that short time and then you've really like sacrificed, you have to, when you're busy, you have to sacrifice something. And so I would find some things to sacrifice for that time. Something that I wanted to do.
Mostly sleep.
Mostly sleep,
and you'd get 3 hours of sleep and you'd study the Bible all night.
Yeah. I would do that.
And pray in tongues all night.
Yeah, know? I would do that. Why? Because why not? Just put it in there.
And God made a way and just cut through the rock.
Yeah, he did.
Cut through the earth. The sands of time just part like the Red Sea.
Yep.
Straight
Miracle.
To the mountain, straight to the top, go up the ladder.
Yep.
You have enough of everything you need for life and godliness already. Just manage it correctly and you will make progress in Christ. Truth anyhow.
Yeah. If the most damaging thing you can do is to take yourself away from training for a false prophet's cave.
Mm.
Like there are some people who are called to do ministry and he will just like take you, like for me, I had to like loosen the death grip on my I had gotten like a promotion and I was finally making the salary that I really wanted to make and everything was in my favor, you know, the customers, the clientele, they loved me, my bosses loved me, I had favor on all sides.
Offering me $250 bottles of wine.
I had all the
expensive liquor.
But I was already quit drinking by the time I got my my final, like, but everything was like perfect in my favor. Everything was going great. So that's a quick story. For those of you who want to get freedom from alcohol,
amen.
If you're not sure, if you feel like you still have the freedom to drink or what, you're not sure about it, or if that's just for the extreme people, if that's not for you, listen, I thought the same way. I didn't see the point. I didn't get it. It's like, if God doesn't tell me to do that, I'm not going to do it. I'm not, because in the past I had tried in my own brain and in my own heart to quit alcohol. And it didn't seem a big deal to me because I was like, you know, I'm not out here being a crazy alcoholic like I was in college, or I wasn't being, you know, I didn't have coping skills, so I used alcohol, right? That was the nefesh. That person is dead. They don't exist anymore. So here's the thing. I was like, you know, well, you know, a little wine is help. That's the whole demon thing. A little wine is good for you. He's like, there's a scripture, blah, blah, blah. It's not that bad. You're in moderation. You know God, you pray in tongues, you blah, 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 right? So, but here's the thing. I asked the Lord about it, and I just said, you know, I'm just going to put it on the table because I don't care. I've already tried to do it on my own. It doesn't really work. I don't really see the point. So, God, if this is your preferred way, this is what you want to do, I'm just going to go ahead and put it on the table, put it on the chopping block. Like everything, just put on a chopping block anyway. And if you want this out of my life, I need you to just take it. Mm-hmm. Because I don't know. I can't figure it out. Are you kidding me? I don't know how to figure stuff out. That's what I told him. I don't know how to figure stuff out. I'm going to need somebody higher than I.
He just took it.
But you know, this is how the enemy gave themselves away. As soon as I stopped that day, I was like, that's not bad. I don't feel like I need it. I don't care. But I'm not going to go any one way or another. I'm going to wait to see what the Lord does.
Amen.
And then all of a sudden, I started having like the craziest, expensive, nicest French champagne bottles offered to me. Hundreds of dollars, like multiple hundreds of dollars worth of wine, special vintages, you know.
Yep.
All
the devil overplayed his
card. It tipped me off. I was like, hold on.
Wow.
Wow, they really want me in alcohol. And I could tell that there was a demon because they tried too hard. They tried way too hard. And so it gave them away. Like, there's like, now the devil wants sipping
saints because they're watered down lukewarm Christians.
The moment I realized that those were demons that wanted me to drink, I like making the devils unhappy. I'm happy when the devils are unhappy.
Amen.
God's happy when the devils are not happy.
Truth.
I felt so empowered in that moment. It went from, I don't know what to do. How do I know what to do? I'm just a human. Like, God, you're going to have to tell me. Like, I'm just a little kid.
Hating alcohol.
Too.
Because the devil loves it.
I could not wait to go back into that situation. I could not wait to go to work the next day and say no because I knew it was coming. I was like, I'm not going to say anything.
You spoke of the chopping block, which, let's talk about amputees and chopping off body parts.
Oh, yeah. Here
because
we go.
In the Civil War, when you had a body part that needed to get chopped off because a grenade or a cannonball hit it or a musket, what would they do? Why don't you drink some whiskey? It'll kill the pain. Guys, up until the 1800s, alcohol is all we had for medicine. Hello?
Yeah.
Alcohol was medicine for thousands of years up until the middle of the 1800s. They didn't have anything else. So we're not barbaric people that need alcohol for medicine, which is the context of drinking a little wine for your belly, Timothy, or your frequent illnesses, it is written. So now you pop a Tylenol or an Advil. Why? Because you're not barbarians anymore.
Yeah.
Hello? And if you're sipping saints and justifying it with some twisting of scripture, you're no doubt in the kelapot, because the kelapot is the place of twisted words from God. That's what the whole kelapot is.
And if you're taking multiple Advil per day, there's also a problem there. That's not correct behavior. But what he's trying to say is, let's have a little sense here. A little sense and reason of the Holy Ghost. But the moment, I just can't tell you how empowered I felt. The moment I realized that the enemy, that the Satans wanted me drinking alcohol, I couldn't wait to go with my happy little face and say, no, I've been waiting all day. I'm waiting 24 hours to say no. With a smile, no, I'm good. And I was, maybe I overplayed my hand. I was a little too happy saying no.
And the devil got offended.
And then they kept bringing a higher... the higher bargain every time. Oh yeah, what about this? It got ridiculous. I was like, these are the demons. I'm gonna keep saying no. It got so over the top. I was like, is that literally a $500 bottle of whatever alcohol this was?
Dump it down the toilet.
Trash.
Right in front of him.
Well, he was like, no.
Take that,
no thanks.
Satan.
And you know, this
might could have been sold for the poor. You're a devil.
And this is, God gave me serpent wisdom too. You want to know the serpent wisdom? The Dan and the Naphtali, the crafty wisdom is, the Lord showed me, don't tell them that's because you're being spiritual. Don't tell them because you're holy. No, I'm too holy for that. What? Like you were just had a drink yesterday. I'm a Christian now. The last 24 hours, I decided.
Oh, yeah.
Now
I'm
holy.
Over here.
Right. He said, don't say that. Mm-mm. Just tell them you're on a cleanse. That's what the Lord told me.
I'm on a cleanse.
Because everybody...
I'm on a juice cleanse.
Everyone was pretty modern around there. Everyone was pretty cool, pretty modern. Everyone can understand a cleanse. They respect and honor diet culture.
Cleanse.
I'm on a cleanse.
Oh, that's awesome.
On a spiritual cleanse from demons, but you don't need to know that right now.
Yeah, because then the human being's like, man, that's actually really cool. You actually get favor with them instead of being a better than you little...
Right.
Because
there was nothing in me that was better than them. I literally had just stopped drinking like the 24 hours ago, so I couldn't really say anything anyway, even though it's the truth.
Oh, now you're better than all of us. I'm bringing my bag.
Real good
witness,
that is.
You see, gone from rebellious demon to religious demon. Now you're twice the son of hell as you were before. No, I'm just on a juice cleanse. Oh, so you still have favor, and you're not a self-righteous hypocrite. We need that, amen?
Like, I'm good. I'm on a cleanse. No, thanks. I'm good.
Amen.
No, thanks. Yeah, I'm good.
Stay in good favor. Don't be religious. Let's go.
And then later on, a few months later, you're like, no, I'm on a roll. Like, I'm on a roll.
Don't call it the wagon.
I'm on a roll
you
now.
You don't need to show your 9-year medallion from
AA. You don't
AA.
Have to over-explain. And here's the thing. You don't have to over-explain yourself to people's demons. You just don't.
But if you want to show your medallion from AA, that's fine too.
That's fine
because we're not legalistic demons.
Right. Amen. So there's some wisdom for somebody.
Stay free.
Yeah, it was amazing. And I'll tell you what, my spiritual growth skyrocketed. Oh, an angel flash was probably here. My spiritual skyrocketed when I completely cold turkey quit any alcohol. And again, I was just, at that point, what people would consider a moderate user. Wasn't going crazy. It was like, you know, refined culture.
50% of Christians are. 50% of born-again, spirit-filled believers drink alcohol casually.
Whew. It's a destiny killer. I'll tell you that.
Yep.
I could not be walking in these heights while drinking alcohol. It can't happen.
It's impossible.
It's impossible, yeah.
I mean, it's madness, but we'll keep it casual tonight.
We'll keep keeping it casual. We don't want to be like too crystal clear and just hurt and offend everyone to the point where they get...
You deal with a five-year-old spirit in heaven, then you have to go soak in the healing pools for...
I can't take it anymore, Lord.
Right? How much truth until you got to go do some soaking in the healing pools of the Garden of Eden just because
that
the truth
so funny.
Just thrashes the Ruah soul and the Nefesh soul. It's all God. You don't need to forgive crystal clear. You don't need to forgive Rebecca. You don't need to forgive me. You just have to go get healing because all of that deceit in you just got thrashed like a fish torn to pieces. And then now you go do some Bible spa and it gets filled with gold. And that's what the oil is for. Amen. The oil isn't always just for your sin and the dumb rebellious crap you've done. No, it's not for that. It's for when the word of God barbecues you as a burnt offering, holy and acceptable for God. Now the oil can mean more of Jesus Christ through all the torn up burnt offering of the soul, the Ruah, and the Nefesh, the flesh. And the Ruah and the Nefesh get totally healed as long as you don't get into bitterness, you get into betterness. Truth anyhow.
Amen. That's so good. This was always encouraging me whenever I'm sore from circumcision. Abraham was recovering. It is written. He was recovering. It's like if Abraham needed time to recover, you know. So it's okay if I need some time to recover, and that's good. Let's take a look at crystal clear. I don't know if you guys have you guys read Anna Rountree's Heaven Awaits the Bride. A lot of you probably have.
100 times.
We've got a lot of new people around here too.
I'm like a
too.
Heaven Awaits the Bride encyclopedia, but I'm still teachable. Let's go.
Oh hallelujah! I love the crystal clear. Okay. After reading this part of Crystal Clear, whenever we went through this book, I started praying and asking for encounters with this angel for her to basically just like shred my existence and tell me every single thing that's wrong with me as clear and concise as possible. So if you want to pray dangerous, scary prayers, pray for this little child angel to visit you. And this is life-changing. Okay. Yeah, and we need it.
Children and old people, they'll tell you
the truth.
They don't have people pleasing.
Bobby Gunner, yeah. Amen. It's good. So good. Okay, so she goes with, may I go with, this is a lady, Anna Rountree. She actually got caught up into heaven. She had a heavenly experience. She goes into heaven, and one of the angels she encounters is crystal clear. And so she asks her tour guide of the angel that she was with, may I go with crystal clear for a few minutes? Looks like a fun little angel to hang out with. Dun, dun, dun. No.
Going in the
little
Garden of Eden
nursery
time. Yeah, right.
That's a dangerous nursery.
It's crystal clear, the butcher.
The butcher, crystal clear. I'm sure she's not even offended by that. May I go with crystal clear for a few minutes? I asked a tour guide. Oh, all right. He said, meet us at the almond grove when you finish. How will I find it? I asked. Crystal clear will show you the way. Yes, I will, she said excitedly. Come along with me. Suddenly, we were on a vast shoreline, but there was no sea. It looked as though the beach was still there, but no ocean. In the sand were all manner of red and blue children's buckets and shovels. Haven't you always wanted to build a sand castle? She asked. I chuckled. Well, not really, crystal clear. Yes, you have, she continued. Think about it. You've wanted to build on Earth? And all of that is sand. When the tide comes in, it goes away. Even the tools for building remain longer than a sand castle, for the tools are from God. But if you use them to build on sand instead of an eternity, what do you have? A waste of time. She shrugged. You have wanted a sand castle. It's silly, really, isn't it? I suppose so, he said quietly. I did not want to admit it, but she was right. I had wanted a home and financial security and accomplish something for God, of course, but I had tunnel vision for the life on Earth. I had Christianized the gospel of the world and bought into my own packaging, it was a bitter thing to hear that the focus of my life had been fleshly and worthless to God, and that I had not gotten away with it. "Do you wanna play?" she continued cheerily. I felt a little sick. She's in heaven. She feels bitter and sick and irritated. How was your trip to heaven? Bitter, sick, and irritated. I felt a little sick. I thought I would change the subject. "Why such a large sand area?" I asked. "Many want to build on sand, so we let them. It gets it out of their systems, you know? Maybe if you build on the sand right now, you would feel I've done that." "Ooh. It seems a silly thing to do," I said stonily. "Well, yes, it does. However, building on the earth is really the same. Silly toys that are long forgotten here. Toys that do not even gather dust in the attic, but disintegrate and are totally forgotten here. A waste of God's precious time," she said much too breezily. I had the taste of a copper penny in my mouth. "Is it all right if we do not play today?" I asked. "Oh, all right," she said. "Do you want to join the tour?"
Notice that her perfect ruah, raptured into heaven by the holy angels, began to feel sick.
Bitter, acid, sick.
Yeah,
irritated.
Notice that now.
Irritated, misunderstood,
stonily. There's truth,
stonely.
Higher of the angelic realms, even if your perfect spirit is in heaven, that will like feel like you're dying.
Yeah.
So this is just to prepare you for how much stuff is on the ladder higher than you, even if you're out of body in the presence of God.
Yep.
Because we don't have much of the fear of the Lord yet. Mm-hmm. You need it.
Yep.
You need it.
"Do you want to join the tour?" "I don't know," I said, dazed. I felt as though I had been hit by a truck. "I like your name, Crystal Clear," I said acidly. "It's apt."
Attacked her.
And
Harua attacked her with, you know, a name.
Word.
You know, and harshness.
Your name, yeah.
Isn't that wild, though?
"Maybe a little rest," she said, as if she had not heard my remark. "Now remember to come back to see us. We love you here. Do keep in touch." She held up her tiny hands, and I held up mine to reciprocate. Light came from hers into mine, and knocked me softly backwards. Have
sure.
a trance.
See you next time.
Remember, heaven loves you. That's your death. Anyway.
Make sure to put an offering on the your way out.
Yeah.
Make sure to give Crystal Clear an offering
take up
on the
offering.
Way out.
Light came from her.
Going back to that church.
In heaven, literally, with the angels.
Yeah, the Garden of Eden.
Light came from hers into mine, and knocked me softly backwards. I lay on the air, as someone might lie on a gurney while being wheeled through hospital. I was like, this is funny. My arms, this is how it is. My arms were across my chest, and I floated down the path like a patient returning from surgery. Amen.
Amen.
Oh, that's good.
Well, that's what it means. God is no respecter of the persons or the personality that was developed apart from his ladder because it's not him, none of it, zero. So obeying him begins to develop that divine part of you so you can really awaken from your hearts, because that's where God's goodness blossoms in you like the Garden of Eden. But it's going to require sacrifices and obedience in your heart against your mind every step of the way until you're many, many worlds in the heavens, and then you start to make much bigger sacrifices, and it's much narrower, and it's much more is required of you, as is written. Whoever is given much, much is required. Well, the higher you go up the ladder, the more you're given. Down in the sand, basically everyone's just fighting off the scraps that come down the ladder, and that's why we have so many thieves around RLM for the last 20 years, just stealing everything they possibly can from me and never giving me credit and never partnering and never donating and say it all belongs to God. No, you're devils. Mm-hmm. And we know you're devils. You've always been devils, and you haven't repented at all. You're going to be severely punished. You're not even as saved as you think you are. You're actually of Esau's camp, and all of that needs to be obliterated in the lake of fire to restore the fear of the Lord in all the earth. And that's going to happen. Mm-hmm. And don't be surprised when people stop showing up for Joel's bar in the comment sections, because they're dead. Because finally, Ananias and Sapphira have been struck down and killed from your midst, because no one clings to the great leaders of a generation like the serpent. So anytime God's doing anything big, you're going to have the serpent there 100% of the time, just like some of you watching right now. Now, the issue is, am I going to allow that serpent nature to be cut off my heart, cut off my mind to obey God and things that are uncomfortable for me? Am I going to be a disciple? Am I going to grow in salvation or harden my heart in the day of hearing the word? That's your response in tonight's offering, in Jesus' name.
Yeah, crystal clear, taking up the offering. Amen. Just wheel me out on the gurney, Lord. Wheel me out on the gurney, Lord.
An offering amongst the thieves and robbers throughout the sands of time, in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen.
Ladies and gentlemen, esteemed guests and beloved supporters, today I stand before you with a heart filled with gratitude and a vision illuminated by faith. We are gathered here not just as individuals, but as a collective force with a shared purpose, to extend a hand of abundance, to bring forth prosperity, and to manifest the heavenly realities in our world. As we embark on this journey together, I am reminded of the words of Proverbs 3, 9, and 10, which says, "Honor the Lord with your wealth, with the first fruits of all your crops. Then your barns will be filled to overflowing, and your vats will brim over with new wine." It is through our acts of honoring and abundance that we have the opportunity to make a tangible difference in the lives of those around us. RLM TV's missions are not confined by geographical boundaries. From the bustling streets of Florida to the sprawling landscapes of America, from the vibrant city of Nairobi, Kenya, to the farthest reaches of the globe, our mission knows no limits. We are driven by a commitment to serve, a commitment rooted in the teachings of Matthew 6:33, where it is proclaimed, "Seek first His kingdom and His righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well." With your support, we have the power to manifest abundance, to uplift communities, to sow seeds of prosperity that will yield a harvest of blessings for generations to come. Your generosity is not merely a financial transaction. It is an investment in the heavenly realities, an investment in the embetterment of our world. In the book of Malachi 3:10, we are reminded that, "Bring the whole tithe into the storehouse, that there may be food in my house. Test me in this, says the Lord Almighty, and see if I will not throw open the floodgates of heaven and pour out so much blessing that there will be not enough room to store it." Let us therefore open the floodgates of heaven with our giving, with the overflow of our hearts, and with the promise of a more than enough abundance. Today, I humbly ask you to join us on this noble journey. Your contributions will enable us to continue this vital work, to reach even further, to serve more, and to manifest the heavenly realities around the world. As you open your hearts and your hands in generosity, may you be blessed abundantly, not just in material wealth, but in the riches of glory, in the joy of giving, and in the knowledge that you have co-created in the building of the kingdom of heaven on earth. As our Jewish sages taught, tithing is the holiness available below. And as our Master Jesus the Christ proclaimed, "Give, and it will be given back to you, good measurements that overflow." Together, let us be the agents of change that our world so desperately needs. Together, let us be the vessels of prosperity that bring forth the heavenly realities. Together, let us make miracles happen. Thank you from the depths of my heart for your unwavering support and your boundless generosity. May the fruitful abundance of heaven overflow in your life. God bless you. Amen.